This is an old-fashioned printing press, invented around 1825 by an Englishman named Richard Whitaker Cope. It's called an Albion. Albion was the first name of England. In fact, if you look at a map, an old map of America, you'll find up along the northwest coast near Seattle was called New Albion at one time. I love printing press history and printing presses. It's a great activity, something both for pleasure and for a livelihood. But I have a more important message on history that I would like to introduce you to today, and that's the history of America, the United States of America. A few years ago, actually about 30 years ago, I had a neighbor that invited me to attend a class called Our American Heritage and the Constitution. That class changed my life, and I'm grateful for that neighbor's invitation. I'd like to invite you to attend a class called Know Your Liberty, and we will teach Our American Heritage and the Constitution. The Know Your Liberty series takes about 8 hours of your time. We're asking you to stop doing something that you like to do and sit down in front of your television set, perhaps with friends and neighbors, and watch a DVD. Watch several of them. Take notes. Start reading the books that are suggested. And take a serious interest in American history. Our Constitution, our Republican form of government, is on the very brink of ruin. And without a large number of citizens taking an interest, we may not preserve what our founding fathers established for us. So the next slide you'll see will be the opening slide of one of the Know Your Liberty series lessons. Please pay close attention. Thank you. The first founding of America. Now this lesson's one of my favorites. For the most part, you're going to enjoy a powerful spiritual element as the founding fathers carry out the will of God. And we'll see just what that is as we introduce it here. We left off in the last lesson with this question: what should we do? And I put this on a scene of haze and smoke. And by the way, that haze and smoke is looking out from the front door of my house. The haze and smoke for the past 2 years of forest fires. And it got so black that at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in front of my house, you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. The smoke and the haze was that thick. Now that's much like it is around us in the United States today. The average citizen can't see past the haze and smoke. They don't know what's happened. They don't know what's happening. And they sometimes don't even care because they don't know something happened. They don't care. What am I trying to say here is, if you don't know there's a problem, maybe you'll be full of bliss and joy. Isn't this wonderful? I have a four-wheeler. My payments on my house are coming in sufficiently by my wife and I both working full-time jobs, and we're able to pay our monthly house payment. Why, life is good. Isn't that how it is? Let's go fishing. Or whatever your activity is you pursue. What should we do? I pondered on this. I've been pondering on it for 3 years. 3 years ago, I was invited to come out of hibernation and start teaching again. I had taken a kind of a vacation for a few years and only taught one lesson a year for several years, and somebody suggested I get back with it and join the cause, and I'm so grateful that they came. The man that did that was Michael Perutka. Some of you know him. He came to visit me in my shop, and that was a turning point in my life. What should we do? What should I teach? I'm not teaching what we taught when I used to teach for the Freeman Institute. People ask me, are you going to teach the Constitution like you used to? No, you can get that on videotapes and audio DVDs. One of the excellent sources is John Eidsmo's Institute on the Constitution. How many have taken that? John Eidsmo's Institute? Oh, this is good. This is good. There's only one raised her hand. You're an audience ready and ripe for John Eidsmo. You can do it in your own front room. Institute on the Constitution. IOTC dot something or other. And you can find out more about it. Okay, that's worth doing. I don't need to do that. I'm teaching you a lesson you cannot find on DVD until we create it ourselves. And some of you have already taken the package. You will not find it in any classroom I've ever heard about. I am teaching what for 3 years I have searched in my heart. What should I teach? What message should every American hear? If you don't know what's broke, you can't fix it. Now that's kind of homespun. If you looked at my hand, you'd see I work for a living. Somebody called me a couple of days ago and I had this dirty, filthy coat on. I wear it every day. And the day before that, I'd been grinding a big old grinder and the hot sparks were flying down on the front of my coat. And I smelled smoke and I looked down, there's big flames coming up the front of my coat like this. And I beat the flames out and there's a big bucket of water right there and I stick my coat down in the bucket and I go back to grinding again. Okay, I make a living. I work for a living. I'm dirty most of the time. I put my necktie on when I come here because I can't teach without a necktie on. I wouldn't be able to. I have a policy. My son and I work together. If you don't know what's broke, you can't fix it. They bring us old wagons. That's our specialty. Fixing old broken wagons or wagons that don't have brakes or something like that. Right now we're putting brakes on a great big show wagon. Oh, really exciting. Makes a living. Pays the bills. The 5,000-year leap on page 31 declares, this is Thomas Jefferson again, preach a crusade against ignorance. No other sure foundation can be devised for the preservation of freedom and happiness. We must overcome the region of ignorance. Intellectual sloth is a phrase I saw in a book this week. We are guilty of intellectual sloth. And in that same line, I was reading there, and it said, the opposite of love is not hate. And I thought, huh? This is just last week I was reading in one of your magazines. The opposite of love is not hate. I thought, well, I always thought it was hate. And I called one of my friends up, the old professor that I called to ask about those words I told you about last night. I says, what's the opposite of love? I thought he was going to say hate. You know what he said? Apathy. Indifference. And I thought about that. I've been thinking about it ever since. The opposite of love is not hate, it's apathy. Do you love America? If you love America, you will do something. If ye love me, keep my commandments, Jesus said. If you love America, obey the rules of freedom and liberty. If you do not, you do not love America. Indifference, apathy, intellectual sloth. You're not guilty of that because you're here. As I pondered on this, the thought came into my mind very clearly, and I think God sometimes helps us to know what to do and where to go. I thought, what should we do? And the thought came in, do what Moses did. And I remember battling with that one for a little while. This was a few months ago, and I thought, what did Moses do? I used to teach at early morning seminary. I taught students the Old Testament. I taught gospel doctrine for 14 years. Taught the Old Testament every 4 years. Do what Moses did. Do what Moses did. What did Moses do? I remember what he did. He changed the... Yes, that's what I'd like to do. If I could change the Potomac into blood. Would Congress then follow the Constitution? No, I'm afraid that wasn't what this inspiration thought was. Oh, I thought of another one, though. I'd like to call a plague of frogs into the Senate chamber. But this was the best one. This is the best one that came to me. A plague of fleas in the Supreme Court. Under those long black robes! But you know, I knew that wasn't what my Heavenly Father was trying to convey to me. Fleas and frogs and blood wasn't going to change the constitutional principles back in Washington, D.C. What was I supposed to do? Do what Moses did. My mind went to the book of Deuteronomy. The fifth book of Moses, called Deuteronomy, the first words read, these be the words which Moses spake unto all Israel. And for the next 20 pages, with fine print and no pictures, Moses gives the story of the history of the people. He tells them about the good things they did and the bad things they did. See, their generation, they've been wandering for 40 years when he gets to this book. And for 40 years, they've been dying off. And the generation that fled from Egypt is now dead. And their children are there. And they don't really know the story. And so this old gray-haired man decides they need to hear their history. And he tells them the bad things they did and the consequences of those bad choices. So that's what I believe I'm supposed to be doing. And so I'm trying to tell the good things and the bad things about the story of America. An old adage, A people must from time to time refresh themselves at the wellspring of their origin, lest they perish. The three foundings of America. This morning we will present the first of the series, the three foundings. Where does the story of America begin? I wrestled and searched my heart, and I thought, where should we start? And then a dear friend from South Dakota sent me a letter. I think God works in ways like this. He sent me a letter filled with information, and he sent me a bunch of pictures. And he said, here's a program I'm trying to develop to teach my friends out here in South Dakota. And I looked at that and I thought, that's where I should begin. And so the first 8 or 10 slides are right out of his program. He collected the pictures, and my heart said, this is the beginning. Where does the story of America begin? For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And he was about his father's business. And he ordained 12 that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach. Wicked men cried, crucify him, crucify him. Following his death and resurrection, his apostles and his followers were gathered and killed. With the loss of the apostles, the organization of the Church of Jesus Christ crumbled, and a long night of spiritual darkness began. Historians call this the Dark Ages. Then God began to raise up great and noble spirits to break through and bring the light forth. One of those great and noble spirits was Martin Luther. He wrote, the spiritual powers have not only been corrupted in sin, but absolutely destroyed. I simply say that Christianity has ceased to exist among those who should have preserved it. Many other great reformers were brought forth through the power of God. And they echoed the same sentiments. For example, John Wesley wrote, the Christians had no more of the Spirit of Christ than the other heathens. One of these great heroes of that time period was William Tyndale. And a few months ago, I was on my way to Boise, Idaho, to go up to a convention. And I knew this exhibit, this where this picture comes from, I knew it was on exhibit in Idaho Falls, and I drove 100 miles out of my way because I wanted to see the exhibit called Ink and Blood. And the ink was the printer's ink that these men gave their lives to see printed on the pages to bring the Bible forth. And the blood was their blood. As they were mauled, maimed, murdered, and persecuted to try and bring the Bible forth in the language of the people that they loved. William Tyndale translated the Bible into English. He was betrayed much as Christ was. By treachery, he was captured, strangled, and burned at the stake. Many persons who adopted his opinions were mauled, maimed, and murdered for striving to live the simple teachings of Jesus. I wanted to see a real Bible. This is a real Tyndale Bible on exhibit, printed in 1536. I just wanted to see what a book looks like that a man is willing to give his life for to see that you would have a copy to read. I stood there in front of this Bible. It was an emotional moment. Tyndale was not alone. There were many others like him whose hearts were set on bringing forth the light. This is a famous engraving representing what happened to Tyndale's Bibles, many of them. The ecclesiastical leadership of England gathered the Bibles and burned them. What does this have to do with American history? Everything. Because Jesus Christ is the God of the land. Thousands of English Bibles were seized and condemned to the flames. The believers who tried to yield their whole lives to Christ were hounded, bullied, tormented, imprisoned, and burned. And many of them then began to try and flee to America. The first boats landed. And that brings us to the first founding on this side of the Atlantic. That's where we're going to focus our time now, this side of the Atlantic. Starting in the year 1607, we're going to take you right, however, to the coastline in 1620. As the pilgrims landed and declared, "For the glory of God and the preservation and advancement of the Christian faith, our pilgrim forebears served the God of the land." Who is Jesus Christ? One of the earliest acts that they passed was the Old Deluder Satan Act of 1647. You see, Satan has various names, and they called him the Old Deluder. And they believed that if children were taught to read, they would be able to read the Bible, this book that men had given their lives for, and they would be able to avoid being deluded by Satan. So that was one of the very first laws, that children should be taught to read so that they could read the Bible in their own language. Thousands of Puritans followed the pilgrims, again fleeing to a land where they could worship God according to the dictates of their own conscience. There were building blocks, I call them the building blocks of the Union. The Mayflower Compact, the Fundamental Orders of Connecticut, the Body of Liberties of Massachusetts Bay, the Virginia Declaration of Rights, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution of the United States, there were more. These are building blocks. And the Constitution and the Declaration could not have been built without the blocks before them. They have something in common. The basic traditions of the United States of America were developed during this time period. One of the basic traditions they all shared in common, these building blocks, was the necessity of a virtuous people committed to the process of searching for the truth. Starting with the Mayflower Compact, all through those building blocks, they insisted you must have a virtuous people committed to the process of searching for the truth. They all agreed, these building blocks, that self-government by a process of deliberation through a representative assembly was the best way to govern a people. And a foundation of the higher law coming from the supreme judge of the universe was the necessary foundation for all of this. The laws of nature and of nature's God. The first founding, 13 colonies became the United States. Now pay attention, heads up. We're going to teach you things you've never heard in your life. I don't care who you are, and I can believe fully with my whole heart I'm telling you the truth. 13 colonies became the United States. Well, y'all knew that already, didn't you? You notice this right here? What is that you? That's a lowercase u. Is that significant? It certainly is. You see, today, and we'll get to that, today we don't believe these 13 colonies became the United States with a lowercase u. Remember last night? Do we say is or do we say are when we put the United States in a sentence? Before 1861, they wrote are. 13 colonies were united in their desire to separate from the mother country. They were not united as a nation, absolutely not. I like this word. I just started using it about a year ago. I came across it in some magazine article, blather, blather. We get so much blather presented to us, nonsense, mythical blather. And we'll give you illustrations, and you'll get some on, if you listen this week to lessons 2 and 3 on that DVD you take home, you'll learn some examples of mythical blather. Here's some right here. This is the truth. This is not mythical blather. They declared their individual sovereignty on July the 4th, 1776. Now, here's some mythical blather about that event. Note 1, the Union was not born on the 4th of July. Of all the stupid nonsense. Have you ever heard that before? Born on the 4th of July. You'll have that probably in Provo on July the 4th. Somebody will be singing that. The Union was not born on the 4th of July. Huh? What are you talking about? Here's another bit of mythical blather. A new nation was not brought forth on the continent, on this continent, on the 4th of July. That's mythical blather. It's total nonsense. Huh? Here's another bit of mythical blather. The sovereign states were not conceived in liberty on the 4th of July. This sounds bizarre. You're all getting able to walk out, aren't you? You're thinking, I'm the guy giving the mythical blather. Hang on. Open your mind. Consider the outlook for slavery. I'm just giving you an example of this mythical blather here. On the 4th of July, what did we do? 13 free, sovereign, independent states declared their independence from Great Britain. How many nations were born on the 4th of July? 13. 13 free, sovereign, independent nations were born on the 4th of July. So if anybody tries to tell you our nation was born on the 4th of July, correct them. There were 13 nations born on the 4th of July. And no one nation was dependent in any way whatever on any other nation. Did the Declaration of Independence come forth conceived in liberty? This is another total nonsense. Were the slaves, and there were a million or two by then, were the slaves offered any benefits because of the Declaration of Independence? Was it any hope for them that they would receive freedom? Liberty? Was there?
Not mentioned.
No. No, there was not mentioned. There was no hope in this declaration for their liberty, nor for their posterity. Well, how about women? Were women being given equal treatment to men in those days? Were women offered increased liberty because of the Declaration of Independence? Come on, give me an honest answer. No, they weren't. So don't tell me it was conceived in liberty. That's mythical blather. Can you handle this? Are you able to take this heavy a load? Let's go on. Notice the date when this book was published. In 2006, three newspaper reporters, Ann Farrell, Joel Lang, and Jennifer Frank, decided they need to explain something that they had come across as reporters for a newspaper. And so they did the research and they printed this book in 2006. Good reading! What do we learn from this book? How the North promoted, prolonged, and profited from slavery. How the North promoted, we always attached slavery to the South. It was those Southerners that were promoting slavery. Not according to complicity. The North was the promoter of slavery, and they were using the slaves in the South. Where did slavery start? What did Thomas Jefferson try to do when he wrote the Declaration of Independence and it was refused and not accepted by the committee? Oh, this is all in this book. Slavery has long been identified in the national consciousness as a Southern institution. The time to bury that myth is overdue. Why did they wait till 2006 to tell us this? Here, for example, we have Jefferson wrote, this is quoting from the book, Jefferson wrote that the king had waged cruel war against human nature itself, violating its most sacred rights of life and liberty in the persons of a distant people who never offended him, captivating and carrying them into slavery in another hemisphere, or to incur miserable death in their transportation thither. This was Thomas Jefferson's suggestion to go into the Declaration of Independence. Did it make it there? No. Why didn't it make it there? These authors suggest for your consideration that the North would have been offended by this statement, and they did not want it in the Declaration. A slave owner, Thomas Jefferson, wanted to show how, when, and where slavery started and accused King George of violating the rights of the slaves. It was not allowed in the Declaration. The Abused Equality Clause. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. What a beautiful statement, and how often it has been taken out of context and completely misconstrued. That's probably the most misconstrued portion of the Declaration. I don't have the time this morning to give you the whole explanation. Just accept that I, Stephen Pratt, do not agree with the commonly distributed nonsense that I call mythical blather with regard to the interpretation of that clause called the Equality Clause. And you're like, huh? What's this speaker trying to suggest? That isn't the way it's meant? My high school teacher told me it means such and such, or wherever you learned about the Equality Clause. I'm just giving you something to think with. Something to think with. We equals the states. The states represented by duly elected ambassadors. The states hold these truths to be self-evident. Now, what else can we learn here? Truths. These truths is plural. One of the truths is that all men are created equal. There are 10 more listed in the Declaration. There are 11 truths. And if we take one out of context, shelve the other 10, are we understanding properly what the meaning is? I see a lot of blank stares, like you're really, really wondering if I'm on the right track. Am I giving you something to think with? Yes. All men does not mean each individual man. He was not talking in the Declaration about each individual man. Huh? Next week I'll bring a handout. I didn't bring it on purpose this week because you're not ready for it. I'm introducing concepts you've never heard before. Next week I'll bring a handout, a one-page article that gives you another viewpoint that you've never heard before. Note, the Equality Clause has been construed in such a way as to cause a derailment in our tradition. It has been abused and derailed American constitutional government. We does not mean the people. When read in context, it appears we means the states. The drafters of the Declaration are maintaining that the Americans are equal to, say, the British or the French, to establish a form of government which shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Now, that's another viewpoint that you probably never heard before. Consider, for example, what did King George acknowledge at the signing of the Second Treaty of Paris in 1783? Now, you can go to my website, libertyandlearning.com, and on the home page you will find a challenge. The challenge is to analyze what the phrase, or what the meaning of the word the Union is. What is the Union? Libertyandlearning.com, the home page, the challenge, a heuristic exploration of the Union. And if you don't know what heuristic is, watch DVD that you're taking home, numbered lesson number 2, and we'll define that there. The Union? We all know what the Union is. That's what got saved during the Civil War. Nonsense. That's more mythical blather. And I'll show you by evidence next week on Friday night what I'm talking about. The Union was destroyed during this so-called war. We give the name the Civil War that was totally uncivil. What's the Second Treaty of Paris say? What did King George acknowledge? In the second, and you can read it on the website. You don't have to go to the Library of Congress to find it. You can, in fact, type in on Google search, Second Treaty of Paris, and there it is in front of you. King George named each individual sovereign state. And he said, after naming them all, you are free, independent, sovereign states. That's what he acknowledged, that they had the right among all the nations of the earth to take their place as free, sovereign, independent nations. Third point. Boy, that was a hard one. We brand that one home. Third point, each new state wrote their own constitution. In fact, some of the states started writing their constitution before they declared independence. Before they declared independence, they were planning the new government. See, we get people sometimes that say, it was a state of anarchy when the declaration was declared. We were in anarchy. That's nonsense. Anarchy is confusion. We were not in confusion. These were people who were being raised up by God to prepare a land of liberty. And they started by writing their own plan of government, each one independent of the other. A plan of federation of sovereignties was conceived. A federation of sovereignties. Last night we talked about three great words. Federalism. A federation of sovereignties. That's what federalism is. Our first constitution, the Articles of Confederation, was written. This is how it appears. Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union. How long is perpetual?
Forever.
These are articles of perpetual union. Can you bind your children to the form of government that you signed the contract to? Can you bind your children? Do you have that authority? Think about that now. Is this little baby out here bound by something that grandfather wrote and signed up in Salt Lake? Ah, think about that. What binds us? How long? Hitler declared he was going to have a kingdom. How long was his kingdom going to last? 1,000 years, the 1,000-year Reich. Would you believe that just shortly after they published the Articles of Confederation that 9 states seceded from the Articles of Confederation? That's how long they thought perpetual was. They had every right to secede because they were free, sovereign, independent states. Ratified near the end of the Revolutionary War, this was a weak union from which 9 states would soon secede. Now they call the Great Convention, the states call the Great Convention. And at this Great Convention, some of the finest scholars the world had ever known, men whom God raised up for the very purpose, came together. And they worked for several months. And they created a plan of government that is acclaimed today as the greatest plan of government ever written in the history of mankind. They called it a more perfect union. We will try to make a better union than the one we had before under the Articles of Confederation. Bernard Jannon Sage's excellent book speaks about this. In fine, the states federalized and did not nationalize themselves. Now get this language. If you don't take any other notes today, get these two words. Federalized, not nationalized. Because in next Friday night's lesson, you'll find out what happened when we got nationalized. In fine, the states federalized and did not nationalize themselves. The former would necessarily be done by equal sovereigns, while the latter would make them counties or provinces of a nation, remanding them to their British condition. Written in 1878. Now there was a tariff dispute. We need to know about this. There was a tariff dispute at the Constitutional Convention in 1787. The leaders of the two different viewpoints were James Madison and George Mason. George Mason and James Madison. The dispute was over how tax law should be passed. Madison said, and his group of supporters, they said, well, we think a simple majority is adequate. Just takes a majority vote and we'll pass tax law when the new government is installed. But George Mason, he says, no, I fear that if we do that, the southern states who will have a minority representation will be overrun by the northern states. He says, I feel we need a 2/3 majority to pass tax law. The great fears at the Constitutional Conventions, I guess I better add to that. Madison won, George Mason was right. And it caused a major rift just 40 years later. great fears when the Constitution was taken before the states. Remember, the states created it. They elected delegates. They sent delegates to a convention. The delegates represented their state. And then they brought the Constitution back and proposed it to the state. Each state individually was given the Constitution suggested by their representatives. The ratification debates by state, their great fears were that the proposed Constitution consolidated the states into a nation. They did not want to be a nation of consolidated states. They wanted to be free, sovereign, independent states, federalized, with a central government having a few enumerated powers, specific and defined. That's what they established in this written document. The proposed Constitution would control the states and do away with their statehood and sovereignty. Now, they feared this. And the fear was so high that at the debates in the various states, some of the states passed the Constitution rapidly, and other states debated it in great detail. Massachusetts passed it barely. Out of 355 votes cast, they only won a majority by 19 votes. That's a close call. In New York, they only won by 3 votes in passing and ratifying the Constitution. In Virginia, a margin of only 10 votes, they barely passed the Constitution. North Carolina soundly rejected the Constitution. They wanted nothing to do with it by a vote of 188-88. Later, however, they called for another convention and they deliberated once again. And they passed it by 193-75. What about Rhode Island? They rejected the Constitution by 2,708-232. They wanted nothing to do with the Constitution. 2 years passed by before they finally called for another convention at which they passed it by a margin of 2. That's how close it was there. What were their 2 great fears? Their fears were that if they had a Constitution like this, the federal government would nationalize them and run over them, and they would lose their identity as a state. Did any of that happen? The first founding includes this step. A voluntary union of states was formed by delegating a few specific and enumerated powers to the federal government, while each state retained its individual sovereignty and right to secede. They retained that. The evidence is overwhelming. When was the Union born? Okay, if I'm going to call it mythical blather to declare it was born on the 4th of July, when was it born? If you turn to your Constitution, Article 7, go ahead and grab it out. If you've got, hopefully you're wearing your Constitution now in your shirt pocket. And by the time I meet with you again next Saturday, it'll start to have some tattered corners. Hopefully you're using it. Turn to Article 7. What page is it on? 15. Okay. Boy, I got this new copy here. I can't even hardly open. 16. There we go, 16. Article 7. Now, we dealt last night in depth on the second sentence in this article. Let's look at the first sentence. The ratification of the conventions of 9 states shall be sufficient for the establishment of this Constitution between the states so ratifying the same. Well, that's pretty important information. How many states are necessary then to ratify and accept this proposal? 9. 9 states. When was the Union born? The 9th state. New Hampshire, July the 2nd, 1788. Is this when the Union was born? No. All they did was ratified. Now they had 9 states that had ratified it, but had they put it into implementation yet? No, not yet. Now they had the right to implement it. So what did they begin to do? The states proceeded to appoint electors and select their senators and representatives to Congress. Now, the appointed electors, what are the electors going to do? What's the elector supposed to do? He's going to choose the president. Did you vote for the president as a state then? No, you didn't vote for the president. You had an elector that represented you. I'd like that today. I'd like to have a trustworthy person from Utah, someone who understood the Constitution, like Bliss II. I'd like to send him back to Washington, D.C. to interview personally the candidates. Yeah. And then he chooses for me because I trust him. But when they come on television with their smooth talk, with their mythical blather, and they tell you all this nonsense about how they'll get more for you, how do I choose? Unless I have a standard. And it's still difficult to do. The elector was the process then. It was a beautiful concept. You sent your most trusted person back to meet with the candidates and decide for you. How about the senators? To select their senators? How did the senators get selected? State. Didn't you vote for the senators? Weren't they just another House of Representatives and you all voted a big mass? No! You had a state legislature, and the state legislature chose the senators to represent the state to protect the sovereignty and independence of the state. Do you see how beautiful this program was? It was a glorious standard. March the 4th, now write this one down. March the 4th, 1789, the Congress, together with the President, did proceed to execute the Constitution belonging to the Associated States. That's a glorious day to remember. Most people have never heard of this date before. So when was the United States or the Union born? Our Constitutional Republic of Republics. That's a strange name. That's the name they called it. Each free, sovereign, independent state was a republic. And they sent delegates to a convention. And the delegates organized a republic of republics. Use that kind of terminology, and then you're accurate telling the truth. Our Republic of Republics was born March the 4th, 1789, where'd that 9 go? During the time period from when the 9th state ratified until they had the government in place and moving, 2 more states ratified. And when it was actually launched and our Republic of Republics was born, by then there were 11 states in the United States of America. Oh, how many states were there? How many were there? 13. What about the other 2? What if these 11 states wanted the other 2 to join? Did they have the authority then to go start burning and killing? If you don't join the union, if you don't stay in this union, we'll kill you, we'll burn your property till you finally agree to be voluntary members of the union. Yeah, that's what they did about 40 years later, 60 years later. You follow this? This is the original plan of government established in the United States. The Constitution. Who's Governor Morris? Governor Morris. This guy's a great character. Governor Morris. I used to teach high school groups this lesson, and I remember down in Texas, they had 415 students every time I went because that's all the seats there were. Oh, those were the days when I had $1 bills. I don't have any $1 bills today. And I used to take out the $1 bills because I didn't have much money then. And I'd hold them up like this, a whole handful of $1 bills. I'd say to high school students, this is tantalizing, say, I'm going to give away some money today. I want to give away money to the people that know the right answers. Who can tell me who wrote the Constitution? Anybody in here want to take that up? Who wrote the Constitution? I'll give you one. Oh, boy. Hands will go up all over the room. Boy, the hands will go up. Yeah, what? Yeah, go ahead. What's the answer? He knows the answer. You don't qualify.
James Madison probably would have been one.
Yeah, always James Madison. Always Thomas Jefferson. And at that point when they said Thomas Jefferson, they blurting them out, you know. Oh, hands will go up. Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, George Washington. They never got the answer. Never got the answer. I never gave any money away. So I finally had to go back to simpler questions. Let's start out with an easy one. Who's the father of our country? I'd always be able to give a dollar away eventually there. But I never had to give any money away when I asked, who wrote the Constitution? Governor Morris. He's the only founding father with a wooden leg. You didn't know that, did you? Trivia. That's trivia, but still fun. When other people would clap, he would stump his wooden leg. Part of the effort to approve of something. Okay, now you've had an introduction to Governor Morris. He was one of the most respected leaders of the Constitutional Convention. Governor Morris was the chairman of the Committee on Detail. When it finally came down to it, Who wrote the Constitution? Could everybody all together write it? Could they all get a pen and each one writes a word and then the next one comes up and writes? How did they do this? They gave the ideas to the Committee on Detail. And the chairman of the Committee on Detail, the chairman wrote the Constitution. He took the pen, he dipped it in the inkwell, and he wrote down the ideas into flowing sentences. And then they debated what he wrote. And then they modified that until they worked out every single word to the satisfaction of the group. He wrote, the Constitution was a compact, not between individuals, but between political societies, each enjoying sovereign power and, of course, equal rights. Now, that's a powerful statement of what actually took place. Sir William Gladstone, Prime Minister of England, declared when he had read this document, he was a greatly loved man in England, this is the most wonderful work ever struck off at a given time by the brain and purpose of man. Now, are we going to use this hand again? This hand represented last night, and it still does, a voluntary compact between free, independent, and sovereign states. A voluntary compact in 1789. The pointer finger is the sovereign states. They're pointing the way. They sent delegates to a convention, and those delegates representing the states wrote a constitution. And the constitution divided the power between the legislative, the executive, and the judicial. This was the structure of federalism as we federalized from 13 free, sovereign, independent states. Did they give up their sovereignty? Is there any such thing as split sovereignty? Oh, there are all sorts of people that will argue, oh, they split their sovereignty. They give a part of their sovereignty away. That's nonsense. You're either sovereign or you're not sovereign. You can't give half your sovereignty away and still be sovereign.
Slightly pregnant.
Yes. That's slightly pregnant, yes. They called this voluntary union the Union of States. They called it the Union of States. And then it became known as the United States. The United States are. This voluntary association of free, independent, sovereign states. Now, the monarchic versus the democratic principles. Monarchic meaning monarchy, democratic meaning rule of the people, not democracy as it's used today. Clarify that. That's important to recognize. Monarchic, coming from Alexander Hamilton. All-powerful central government. He said in one of his statements, the people, gentlemen, I tell you, the people are a great beast. We can't let the people decide and rule themselves. The people are beast. We've got to have people who are qualified leaders. The monarchy, or something thereof, the equivalent thereof. Now, in contrast to that, Jefferson declared the rule of the people. Governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. It's the proper role of government to operate by consent of the governed. And when a government refuses to operate by the consent of the government, or the consent of the governed, they're ruling in unrighteous dominion. Hamiltonism summed up in these words. Create a strong central government similar to that of England. The main public offices were to be held by the rich and the noble for long periods or for life. Maintain a large standing army. Provide for a national bank and a heavy public debt owned by the favored few to whom the common masses could pay tribute under the guise of interest. These are concepts coming from Alexander Hamilton. By the way, his state of New York was not well represented at the convention. How many states were represented with enough delegates to vote at the convention? 11. Rhode Island never sent any delegates. New York sent 3. 2 of them got fed up with it because they were Tory-type individuals and they went home. Alexander Hamilton went home also for a time. When he eventually came back, he didn't have voting power because he didn't have a majority from New York's delegation. So there are only 11 states that had voting power at the Constitutional Convention. Alexander Hamilton stood and gave his opinion. Here's how I think we should organize our government. Did they embrace these ideas and say, yes, Alexander, that's wonderful, we'll write that into the document? No, on the contrary, they said, no, Alexander, thank you, but no. And that's when he went home, came back sometime later. Now, contrast that. Oops, there's one I didn't put down. You don't overlook this one. Enact prohibitive tariffs under the guise of protection. Okay, these are the 5 points of Hamiltonism. Compare that to Jeffersonism. Assign to the central government only specific enumerated powers. Separate the powers of government both vertically and horizontally. This is protection, vertically and horizontally. And the young lady brought up a beautiful diagram of it, showing me a pyramid. Catherine, is that your name? Yes, Catherine brought up a beautiful diagram showing me a pyramid. The people are at the bottom, and the central government's up at the top up here, and it emanates, it's divided. We have the central government, we call it the federal government. We have the state governments, the county governments, the city governments. We have the family, which is the lowest level, the most foundational level of government. We have horizontal division of government. At the federal level, we have legislative, executive, judicial. At the state government, we have a similar division. And at the family level, we have father and mother as a horizontal division of power. This is the structure upon which America was founded. Follow a written constitution strictly, and change it only by amendment. In questions of power, then, let no more be said of confidence in man, but bind him down from mischief by the chains of the Constitution. Which plan did we adopt? Hamiltonism or Jeffersonism? We adopted Jeffersonism. He wasn't even there. He was in France. But he wrote copious notes and sent them to James Madison, who became known as the father of the Constitution. George Edmonds was a woman. Her name was Elizabeth Meriwether. Women still hadn't gained enough recognition in that day to dare publish their name on the front of a book. So she put a man's name on her book in the year 1904. It's a good book. It's well worth reading. Facts and Falsehoods Concerning the War on the South, 1861 to 1865. The students of New England history, or the student of New England history, knows that from the very formation of the Union, New England's foremost politicians were dissatisfied with it and began to plan and plot to bring about disunion. Now, she's writing a brief history of this war we call the Civil War. So what was the problem? People in New England had dissatisfaction, and they were starting from the very beginning to call for non-union, a disruption, or plot to bring about disunion. She goes on, as early as 1796, men of Massachusetts began to talk of New England seceding from the Union. In 1796, they wanted to secede because of their own selfish reasons. They were interesting. It's interesting reading. She goes on. Then, in 1796, New England writers, preachers, and politicians deliberately began the wicked work of poisoning their minds against the southern states to sow hostility, discord, and jealousy between the different sections of the Union was the first step New England took to accomplish her favorite object, a separation of the states. Now, she then gives quotations from the sermons and the written papers that were coming forth in 1796 to build her case, giving evidence for her assertion here. Elizabeth Meriwether. Now I ask you, what is the Union? You know, I haven't had anyone in an audience yet that could give me a correct answer. The Union, according to our founding fathers. What is the Union? I wish we could discuss it for an hour here. That'd be good for us. But let me just shorten down that discussion time by putting a definition on the board or on the screen from 1825. That's where this definition comes from. But before we give it, let me reason through, help you to have something to think with. What is the union? When we speak of the string, a string of pearls, this is the reasoning come from Bernard Sage. When we speak of the string of pearls, what is the most important? The string or the pearls? Oh, that wasn't too hard, was it? Okay, let's try another one. When we speak of a bag of gold, what is the most important? The bag or the gold? That wasn't too hard, was it? When we speak of the union, what is the most important? The union or the free, sovereign, independent states? Oh, but guess what? No one knows what the union is today. The definition's totally gone. I've never found it in a modern textbook. I had to go back to 1825 before I finally caught on an understanding of, like, I finally understand. Thanks to William Rawl, I finally understand. And somebody had to reprint William Rawl's book, and so I called that man, and I thanked him. Thank you for reprinting this old, wore-out textbook. William Rawl was a contemporary of the Founding Fathers. He was there with George Washington. George Washington, when he became president, asked William Rawl to become the first, or not the first, but one of the Attorney Generals of the United States. Now, does that give you any credibility for William Rawl? George Washington loved William Rawl and respected his thinking, and he said, would you be the Attorney General if I, he had to still get approval from Congress, but William Rawl said, no, I'd rather stay home and practice law in Philadelphia. William Rawl wrote the second to earliest constitutional textbook used at West Point and other leading institutions of higher learning. The name of his book, The View of the Constitution of the United States, chapter 32, is titled, Of the Permanence of the Union. And then, what do you suppose he does in the next 15 pages? He tells you what the Union is. He describes the Union in detail. He explains to you that the free, sovereign, independent states can secede. They're voluntarily in there and they can secede if they desire. He gives you the most honest, down-to-earth explanation of the Union that I have ever seen. And it takes 15 pages to do a good job. I mentioned to you the lady that said to me, oh, Mr. Pratt, I like your lectures, but why do they have to take so long? Why did he take 15 pages to define the Union when you can boil it down to this? This is 15 pages sucked into one sentence. The Union is a voluntary association of the people of two or more representative republics. That's the Union. If two of the original 13 states wanted to be together after they had followed the plan of the Constitution, if some of them wanted to secede, they could secede. But William Rawl says you would need two to maintain a union. Just two. If the others try to secede, should we start killing and burning them? No, William Rawl says it's voluntary. You can't do that. That was in 1825. To coerce a seceding state would be suicidal to freedom. Elizabeth Meriwether's quoting another earlier scholar in her book. To coerce a seceding state would be suicidal to freedom. What happened to freedom when the seceding states were coerced? It was lost. Our nation committed suicide. What is the Union? Wendell Phillips was a United States Senator. We'll quote him again on Friday night next week. What is the Union? He declared in 1860, a union is made up of willing states. If you don't want to be in there, if you're not willing, you can withdraw, because it's not a union unless you're willing voluntarily to be there. Something came about called unionolatry. They began to worship the bag instead of the gold. They began to worship the string instead of the pearls. They began to worship the Union instead of the free, voluntary, sovereign states. Worship of the Union, they called it. Serve King Union was another phrase I picked up in some other textbooks. Meanwhile, 40 years after Mason-Madison controversy, remember we introduced that earlier? 40 years after the Mason-Madison controversy over whether a majority or a two-thirds majority should be used, the majority vote, the North imposed protective tariffs by majority vote. For example, the Tariff of Abominations of 1828. Now, it was about this time that South Carolina said, we can't tolerate this anymore. You're violating our rights, and we no longer want to be a part of this voluntary association. We will either nullify what you have passed and tried to foist upon our state, or we will secede. Do you remember that bit of history? Usually it's covered in some book somewhere. And so we're told that South Carolina was about ready to secede, and so great men like Henry Clay and others came in, and they, you know, they had deliberations, and it was postponed for a few years. Satan goes about deceiving nations. How does Satan deceive a nation? When they passed the old Deluder Satan Act in 1647, they were trying to have the children read the Bible. How does Satan deceive? The old deluder does this by deceiving individuals, leaders, and teachers. Hopefully, the higher he can go, the quicker it'll happen. If we can suck in the leaders and the teachers to believe mythological doctrines, mythical blather, with other words, then we can deceive the whole people because the teachers will pass it out to their students. Enter. Oh, this is an interesting part of the lesson here. Again, you're hearing things you have never heard before. Nathan Dane, Joseph Story, and Daniel Webster. Three famous characters from the past. They got together in the 1830s. Now, a little brief background on who these people are. Nathan Dane was a prominent lawyer, drafted the Northwest Ordinance of 1787. That makes him very prominent. He published the first law textbook just before William Rawl. This man published his textbook in 1823, William Rawl in 1825. He founded the Massachusetts School with Story and Webster. Now, the Massachusetts School, to the best I can discover, was not an institution. It was not a building or a campus. It was what we would call today a think tank. Now, we have think tanks around. And one of those think tanks that has a building that are called the Council on Foreign Relations. And they're a think tank. And these brilliant geniuses get together and they think. Only thing that bothers me about where they think is the name of the place in which they think. The Council on Foreign Relations meets at the Pratt House. They had a think tank. I don't know where they met, but they met in Massachusetts. Now let's give you a little bit of background on the next character here. Joseph Story, a very famous, famous justice of the Supreme Court. He was considered the most learned scholar ever to sit on the Supreme Court. He was the Dane Professor of Law at Harvard. Now Dane is the Nathan Dane. Nathan Dane was old enough to be the father to these other two gentlemen. Nathan Dane had a lot of money. He contributed a sizable amount to the Harvard Law School. So when Joseph Story came along, he got the position of Dane Professor of Law at Harvard. He construed the Constitution in favor of expanding federal power. You know where I got that sentence? Out of the encyclopedia. I looked up this guy's name in the Encyclopedia Britannica. And they used the word construed. And I thought, that's interesting. Is construed something we do with a contract? Do we take our building contract and construe it? No, we follow its face value. What does it say? We don't construe it. In the encyclopedia, I already knew this from other reading, but in the encyclopedia they said he construed the Constitution in favor of expanding federal power. What was one of the greatest threats that the states felt when they went to their state conventions? Is expanding of federal power. Now this man did it. He expanded federal power. He engaged in behind-the-scenes political activity. That's a phrase again from the Encyclopedia Britannica, which included the Massachusetts school. That part is not in the Encyclopedia Britannica. They did not put in the Massachusetts school. The Massachusetts school is a phrase coming from Bernard Sage. And to this day, I can't find another source that gives me that name. So I'm relying on one scholar using the phrase Massachusetts school. However, there are other scholars that show what happened with these three men, that they didn't necessarily name the name but Massachusetts school, but they showed their thinking, their ideology. Oh, this character here, Daniel Webster. Daniel Webster, the great God. Webster. This is a phrase used to describe him. One of the greatest lawyers in American history. United States Senator, Secretary of State, co-founder of the Massachusetts School. So we have these three characters. Now, I got done with this lecture a few weeks ago and somebody came up, "Oh, I'm most disappointed to hear about the man that wrote the dictionary. Blew it." Okay, let's do some slides. I added this slide since then. Do not confuse Noah Webster with Daniel Webster. Okay, don't get confused here. Noah Webster and Daniel Webster were two different people. Noah Webster's dates shows that he was born about 18 years before the Declaration of Independence, and Daniel Webster was born about 6 years after the Declaration of Independence. 24 years between them, that makes Noah Webster old enough to be Daniel Webster's father. I don't know if there's any relationship. I can't find a hint that they were related in any way. They just happen to have the same name. Now, Noah Webster was a great American. Daniel Webster has a track record. We hear him quoted all the time. But by the 1830s, kind of like we quoted from, Alan Greenspan this morning. What did he say as a young man? And what did he say when he became the chairman? So that same kind of thing happened with Daniel Webster. As a young man, he said things that were true. And then as he got older with more prestige and power, he started saying things that were false. Noah Webster's noted for his great dictionary. How many of you own the 1828 Noah Webster dictionary? Oh, wonderful, wonderful, a great show of hands. I just bought my copy recently. I felt I was not prepared without it. I'll show you why. I'm going to show you a quote from the 1828 and compare it to what happened with Daniel Webster's influence. Noah Webster also wrote the Blueback Speller. The Blueback Speller was the best-selling book in America. In fact, I think it still holds that record next to the Bible. More Blueback Spellers sold than any other book. More than 100 million copies. And is a great contribution to the development and the growth of a good American youth. The contributions made by Noah Webster. They were profound and valuable. Now, let's take a comparison here. If we go to Bernard Sage, in chapter 12, the title of the chapter is Verbal Jugglery. Now, what's juggling? We take balls or we take 10 pins or something, we start throwing them up and we juggle them around. What's verbal jugglery? We're taking words and we're juggling words. He has a whole chapter on this as Bernard Sage explains what the Massachusetts school did to Noah Webster's dictionary. Oh, let's take a real example. Now he gives a whole chapter of examples. Let's read first the few comments here. After contrasting the doctrines of the two Washingtons, it is well to bring to view in the same line of investigation the two sets of so-called definitions of Noah Webster. As to the matter in hand, one genuine and the other counterfeit. With sapping and mining industry equal to that of a species of rodent vermin and quite as difficult to follow and counteract. A certain class of teachers and leaders have undermined to its ruin the sacred temple of constitutional freedom. Now, when is he writing this? 1878. In 1878, he says there are certain teachers and scholars who have undermined the constitutional principles of freedom. Huh? In 1878? Yes, that's next Friday night's lesson. Unfortunately, they and their disciples are followers mainly, unfortunately, they and their disciples or followers mainly control the political propagators, print, press, publishers, politicians, and in short, the most of the means of political teaching in the whole land. Does that sound familiar? If we could just control the websites, if we could just control the newspapers, the television, the evening news, if we control the magazines, we could control you. And that's what he's saying in 1878. They took control of the media at that time. Now what happened? Thimble rigging. Thimble rigging exposition. In 1830 to 33, Daniel Webster abandoned his previous and sound constitutional views and played most skillfully with double senses and with false debate. Said he, "Words are things of mighty influence because a just conclusion is often avoided or a false one reached by the adroit substitution of one phrase or one word," or he might have said one definition for another. Oh, and then Bernard Sage begins to give examples of the word changes, the definitions of words from the Noah Webster Dictionary of 1828 and the 1864 Noah Webster Dictionary after his death. I will give you one illustration and you will grasp it quickly. You will see what happened. Now, he uses the 1844 edition. That's why I bought the 1828. I wanted to see if it was the same definition. It's word for word the same. In 1844, Noah Webster's influence was still in his dictionary, even though he had died 1 year earlier. I believe Bernard Sage used this to show the short time span in which corrupt men can influence people for evil. In 1844, the definition of the word Congress reads, "The assembly of senators and representatives of the several states of North America, according to the present constitution or political compact, by which they are united in a federal republic." Are you catching the language? Bernard Sage italicized the phrases he thought would be most helpful here. Pay attention to the assembly of senators and representatives of the several states of North America, according to the present constitution or political compact, by which they are united in a federal republic. Boy, that's a clear statement of truth. The legislature of the United States, consisting of two houses, a Senate and a House of Representatives. Now get ready to have your mind blown. What you're going to see is the definition we see today. And you'll think, well, that doesn't blow my mind. That's just the way it is. Can you handle it now? Get ready. Congress, the assembly of senators and representatives of the people of a nation, especially of a republic, for the purpose of enacting laws and considering matters of national interest, and constituting the chief legislative body of a nation. Does anybody see any problem there?
Yeah.
Boy, if you don't, stay over after and talk it over with me. Noah Webster's Dictionary of 1844 and 1864 is an example of what the social do-gooders were doing at this time period. The states federalized, not nationalized. Now you're hopefully catching on why I jump up and down up here so many times to explain that the states were free, sovereign, and independent, and they federalized. Federalism, enumeration, and separation were the doctrines of freedom established in the founding of America. The Massachusetts school had a doctrine or an ideology. Here some of the concepts are from the quotations from their literature. They say that the Constitution teaches that we, the people of the nation, do ordain and establish that what the nation ordains is the supreme law of the land, and that all powers not delegated by the nation in this Constitution are by the said nation reserved to the states respectively or to the people. Now, is that confusing? You just want to go home and ride your four-wheeler or mow the garden? Hang on there. Bright, keen intellect. Let your mind work on this and understand what happened clear back then. Here's another concept from the Massachusetts School. What the Massachusetts School desired was an all-powerful central government over one nation, indivisible. Socialist activist Francis Bellamy would later incorporate this language into the Pledge of Allegiance. One nation, indivisible, is socialist dogma coming from the Massachusetts School. Well, this is thought-provoking, isn't it? The people of the United States are a nation, one sovereign people, represented by a national government, which is possessed of absolute supremacy, so far as its vested powers go, and is the exclusive judge of the extent of said authority. Now, this is 1878, that a man is publishing what these people were thinking in 1830. Massachusetts School Doctrine. The nation ordained the Constitution. Is that who ordained the Constitution? Did the nation create the Constitution? Who created the Constitution?
States.
The states created the Constitution. That's a lie. The nation ordained the Constitution, and that, as it is the supreme law of the land, state sovereignty is effectually controlled by it. Now, we're clear back. We're looking at what happened between 1830 and 1860. This is what we're looking at right here. The Massachusetts School, summarizing, a federacy was changed to a nation of provinces called states. They still called them states, but their power or their sovereignty was eliminated. The central government is the supreme law of the land. What's the supreme law of the land? The Constitution is the supreme law of the land. The central government is not the supreme law of the land. The central government is the final judge of its own authority. A state and a county are equal in rights. Now again, we're summarizing doctrines taught 150 years ago. And they became popular. And they swept across the country. And a vast group of people began to accept it. But I don't want to spill the beans. That's for next week's lesson. I want to tell you who they are, who accepted it. What is a faction? A group of people in an organization who have common interest, usually in opposition to the principles or aims of the main body or leadership. Faction, partisan conflict within a county or a country. Okay, that's a faction. Now, the Massachusetts School, they were first a faction, a small group of individuals who didn't agree with the general thinking of the country. Then they became an enterprising minority as they used the media to spread their doctrine. And finally, a victorious party engaged in overthrowing constitutional liberty, a gigantic faction, and what do you suppose the name of this political party was? Could anybody dare say it out loud? The Republican Party. This is where they came from. They were an extension of the gigantic faction. And in 1861, they had the power to place a candidate into office. And that's next Friday night's lesson. What happened? Ah, this is a relief shot. People say, what should we do? There's nothing we can do. I hear that more often nowadays. Oh, there's nothing we can do. You ever hear that from any of your friends and neighbors? Oh, there's nothing. Well, why would I want to spend Saturday morning down there listening to a lecture on American history? There's nothing we can do. And some people say, God is in charge. It's God's will. Whatever's happening is the will of God. You heard that kind of reasoning? You're going to blame it on God? This is a sailboat. I looked for a sailboat so I could represent the Bonhomie Richard. Do you remember the story of John Paul Jones? I warm inside as I think about it. He was on the Bonhomie Richard, an older ship with not enough guns, poorly equipped. And John Paul Jones was out representing the United States. And there was this massive English warship called the Serapis. And the Serapis and the John Paul Jones Bonhomie Richard came together in conflict, in battle. They started shooting each other. But the Serapis had more guns and they were bigger. And the poor Bonhomie Richard was all punched full of holes. So what did John Paul Jones say? He said, jump into the ocean, man, and swim for the Serapis. It's our last hope. They'll put us in prison, and we'll be in prison for a while, but then we'll be free. Isn't that what John Paul Jones said? He said, this ship's going to sink. We're in big trouble. Sail up right beside the Serapis and tie on. We'll tie our ship to the Serapis and we'll board. We'll take them over by force. So when the commander of the Serapis looked at the situation, he didn't know what John Paul Jones was like. He didn't know the kind of man he was dealing with. And he said, do you give up? And what was John Paul Jones's famous statement?
I have not yet begun to fight.
I have not yet begun to fight. And he tied the two ships together. And his men, undoubtedly like they show in Hollywood, they probably grabbed hold of ropes and swang over. I suppose they did. I don't know how they got from one boat to the next. They crawled over somehow. And they had hand-to-hand combat until they caused the British troops to give up and they locked them in their own hold. And then they cut the Bonhomie Richard loose and watched it sink into the sea. So the next time your friends and neighbors say, oh, why are you spending Saturday down there listening to a history lecture? There's nothing we can do. I've just begun to fight. It's a battle of words. And it must be done kindly and gently. The Spirit of God must be in the cause of liberty. For the gospel of Jesus Christ is the perfect law of liberty. And if you're going to explain liberty to your friends and neighbors and your family, you must do it from a kind and a gentle perspective. We showed this slide earlier. Last night I showed it. I regret deeply that I didn't invite you to sing last night. I was supposed to push the button one more time, and we would have sang a hymn to close our evening meeting. I can't wait to see what comes up next because I've forgotten. Last night we reminded you of the great statements here that Christ made to his apostle Peter. When thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. Oh, I'm glad that came up. Would the audience please rise? This is one of the great hymns, a great prayer. There are actually two verses to it, so when we've sung this verse, oh, by the way, back here, what do you suppose the last thing they did was before they parted? And they sung an hymn. You read that in this account. And they sung an hymn. And so before we part today, we're going to invite you to sing an hymn. Now, this hymn is a very famous hymn. We're going to sing this verse, and then we'll flash the next verse on the screen. Now, the next verse was written... Oops, am I going the wrong direction? I'm going backwards. Let's go this direction. The next verse on the screen. Notice this verse was written in 1640. See the down in the corner? It was in one of the earliest, if not the very earliest, printed book in America. They called it the Bay Psalm Book, a book of hymns, printed in 1640, praising Jehovah. So let's see if I can lead you through this song effectively. I wish they had a piano player that could play that for us. Are you able to do it? To go through it once then so that we kind of let you warm up at the piano. Can you do it without music? If there's a hymn book there, it'd be wonderful if we could hear the... I always start it too high and we always think that we're in soprano choir here. No hymn book. Okay, we'll sing it a cappella. We're going to... Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Shout to Jehovah all the earth. Serve ye Jehovah with gladness. Before Him come with singing mirth. Know that Jehovah, He God is.
We'd like to invite you to watch the next DVD. We'll be creating it soon. We'll offer these DVDs at a very low, low cost off of our website. Please look at the website to see availability. Thank you.